Welcome to Utopia Satirectory. Special welcome to anyone who's just come across us for the first time. Lovely to have you with us, but lovely to be sharing worship with those who've travelled with us on a long journey now. I hope that you feel fully part of this online worship today and that you find you can meet with God through this service. In our gospel reading today, we will hear how Jesus is the true vine and we are the branches who are called to bear much fruit. So we come together to worship, to affirm our dependence on God and to commit to being fruitful disciples. Our opening hymn this morning is Guide Me, O Thou Great Redeemer. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So we have a time of confession. Let us come before God in thankfulness and humility, acknowledging those ways in which we have failed to be faithful disciples. For the times when we have kept your love to ourselves and not shared it with those around us, Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. For those times when we have known what you require of us, but chosen not to do it. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. For those times when we have been less than you created us to be and missed opportunities to glorify you through our lives. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness and keep you in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So we hear our first readings today.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles, Acts 8, verses 26 to the end. An angel of the Lord said to Philip, "Get up and go towards the south to the road that goes from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is the wilderness road." So he got up and went. Now there was an Ethiopian eunuch, a court official of the Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, in charge of her entire treasury. He had come to Jerusalem to worship and was returning home. Seated in his chariot, he was reading the prophet Isaiah. Then the Spirit said to Philip, "Go over to his chariot and join it." So Philip ran up to it and heard him reading the prophet Isaiah. He asked, "Do you understand what you are reading?" He replied, "How can I unless someone guides me?" And he invited Philip to get in and sit beside him. Now the passage of the scripture that he was reading was like this. Like a sheep, he was led to the slaughter, and like a lamb silent before its shearer, so he does not open his mouth. In his humiliation, justice was denied him. Who can describe his generation? For his life is taken away from the earth. The eunuch asked Philip, "About whom, may I ask you? Does a prophet say this, about himself or about someone else?" Then Philip began to speak, and starting with his scripture, he proclaimed to him the good news about Jesus. As they were going along the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, "Look, here is water. What is to prevent me from being baptized?" He commanded the chariot to stop, and both of them, Philip and the eunuch, went down into the water, and Philip baptized him. When they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord snatched Philip away. The eunuch saw him no more, and went on his way rejoicing. But Philip found himself at Azotus, and as he was passing through the region, he proclaimed the good news to all the towns until he came to Caesarea. This is the word of the Lord.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said, "I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower. He removes every branch in me that bears no fruit. Every branch that bears fruit he prunes to make it bear more fruit. You have already been cleansed by the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered, thrown into the fire and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. It's inevitable that we must encounter Jesus through the filters of the gospel writers. With perhaps 3 years of the Jesus ministry to generate the original events and memories on which the Gospels were based, and a few decades of telling and retelling the stories before they were recorded, that we are fortunate that virtually all the material selected is sufficiently fresh and vivid to stand the test of time. So although the texts are some 2,000 years old, they're still relevant for us today. John, for example, has picked up on a number of metaphors Jesus is said to have used. Each one of these is related to human experience. I am the true vine. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the light. And as we heard last week, I am the good shepherd. Today's gospel picks up the striking image of Jesus as the true vine. If we go back a little, we see that Jesus is addressing this to his disciples, those who have already chosen to follow him. So as we consider what he's saying, we might wonder if John chose to record such words for those in the church who intend to follow Jesus' teaching. The grapevine was an image well known to the Jews. The historian Josephus describes the temple in Jerusalem as having golden decorations on its entrance archways with human-sized depictions of grape clusters on a grapevine. The scriptures referred to the Jews as God's vine stock, damaged by captivity in Babylon and brought to Israel. The prophets also captured this image, and Isaiah, Hosea, Ezekiel and the psalmists all use the same metaphors of the Jews as part of the vine and of God as the vine dresser. In the book, the Gospel of John, the image is expanded and the new branches on the vine are taken to mean the Gentiles who are now part of this picture. The bit about the non-fruiting branches being destroyed may even have been partly John's addition, because he was writing at a time when the temple had already been destroyed and the Jews driven from Jerusalem. It might be said by some that Jesus as the true vine is only a metaphor, a figure of speech. Yet metaphors can remind us of truth that we may prefer to overlook. For example, it may seem a minor point, but a vine that is grown for fruit production is only cultivated for that one reason. If it doesn't produce the fruit, it's got no other purpose. It doesn't particularly look pretty. So for those who believe that the purpose of church is getting together just for worship, this may be to miss Jesus's point. It may even be worth reflecting on how those in the community might view the fruit being produced. Now, a local grocery or fast food shop has a discernible purpose for a community. If our local church were to disappear tomorrow, it is worth asking why it would be missed. What good fruit is produced there? What difference does it make? Now, I want to suggest that the chosen metaphor of Jesus as the true vine is both helpful and thought-provoking. And it's true that any metaphor can be subject to unwise interpretation. But if nothing else, using a true vine is good gardening practice. The standard practice is to select the good fruiting vine with great care, and having identified the one required, take cuttings and graft them onto separate rootstock. Simply being in the same vicinity as the well-grafted stock won't do it. So let's think about that in church life. Joining a congregation where there are warm and active Christians doesn't mean that all who are associated with that congregation will have those same characteristics. Each individual shoot must be considered separately. Now, if we look back over the last 2,000 years, we see all too often it has not always been Jesus's teaching with his central principles of compassion, forgiveness, peace, justice and acceptance, which have always been at the centre of the expression of the church. But rather sometimes It is as if there is a graft to power, position, local custom, exclusivity and religiosity. Families are linked automatically by relationships put in place by happen chance of birth. You may not always like your cousin or your brother or your aunt, but there is a tie which is there as a right of birth. This is not so with faith. In the case of the vine of Christianity, we're not linked to the family tree as of right, nor are we linked to the vine by self-labels like being born again, being evangelical or liberal or conservative. The fruits of faith are seen in our attributes to one another, rather than in our statements of faith. If the branch is not productive, or if it begins to die, horticultural practice suggests it should be removed. Here it's not clear if Jesus was talking about the person or the characteristics of a person, or even if his words should apply to whole communities. Most of us, if we are human, will have human failings as well as human gifts. Our faith communities are unlikely to be exempt. In this observation, Jesus is saying more than we know to be true. Not all parts of the vine produce good fruit, and not all dimensions of human behaviour are acceptable. It's all very well to agree in principle to love enemies, to love the poor and fight for the disadvantaged, but in practice, it is difficult to do that alone. Perhaps we get a hint of how to at least start becoming a productive part of the vine in Jesus' words of encouragement. I am the vine, you are the branches. If you abide in me and I in you, you bear much fruit, but apart from me, you can do nothing. As with Paul's words of encouragement in 1 Corinthians 13 and in the reading from 1 John 4 today, the phrase abide in me is an instruction to engage in a series of deliberate acts rather than a feeling. Building Christian community may start with the identification of the theory of Christ's teaching, but as long as it stays with reading and hearing about Jesus and his interaction with those who would follow, it will remain unrealised. Jesus talks of those areas of the vine not producing fruit. This calls for honesty and not, as many seem to think, only honesty about the lack of applied Christianity in others. The fruit of the gospel in our lives should be apparent to strangers, to friends, to neighbours, and not least to ourselves. What is required is that we actually need to follow Jesus' example of caring about those who are not necessarily deserving of our care. We need to be peacemakers, not just in theory, but in diffusing actual disputes. We need to be identifying and meeting injustice. And above all, we need to be serving others. In short, we need to be abiding in Christ. When it comes to identifying the useless parts of the vine, knowing that others are likely to have weaknesses may be a truth. But Jesus' notion that the vine will have weaker parts reminds us that we too may have weaknesses, and maybe what is required is not so much judgment of others as helping one another overcome our weaknesses. Jesus reminds us that we have to be ruthless in dealing with weaknesses that get in the way of producing fruit. Nowhere does he say only in other people. So finally, I want to suggest that whether or not the metaphors used to help us understand Jesus are going to make a difference will ultimately depend on whether or not we truly believe Jesus' teaching is for the community that we inhabit in the setting of a real world. So if there was good news in Easter and we're still in the Easter season, it has to be good news for the life we and others live. The true vine produces the fruit. So may others find in us the evidence of that true vine. Amen. Let us pray. Jesus said, "If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish and it will be done for you." Trusting in his word, we bring our prayers before God. We pray for the church, for all the disciples of Jesus who seek to bear fruit in the world. We pray for the local community of church that we worship amongst, those who we physically can be with in a building and those who we're physically with online. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the world that God has created and for all those who have hard decisions to make for the common good. As our local elections take place this coming week, we pray for all those who will be given positions that are there to support local people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our community, that we may see those places where we need to bring God's love and peace. As our lives start to have fewer restrictions, we pray for those who are finding it difficult to engage back with community and community life. Pray for those who are fearful, those who are angry, those who are hurting, those who are lost. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all who suffer in mind or body, in illness, poverty or despair, asking God to show us how to bring loving care to them. And we have a moment of quiet to bring before God anyone whom we know in need of prayer today. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all those who have died, that they may find eternal peace, and for those who mourn them, that they may be comforted. And we bring before God any whom we know. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving God, your Son has promised that our prayers will be heard. We trust in that promise and we ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
To the Lord, all the earth let us sing, power and
The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. Father, you made the world and love your creation. You gave your Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Saviour. His dying and rising have set us free from sin and death. And so we gladly thank you with saints and angels, praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We praise and bless you, loving Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And as we obey his command, send your Holy Spirit, that broken bread and wine outpoured may be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends, and taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread, gave it to them, and said, Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine, again he praised you, gave it to them and said, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did, in whom we plead with confidence, his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. bringing before you the bread of life and cup of salvation. We proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day when your kingdom comes and justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favour on your people. Gather us in your loving arms and bring us with all the saints to feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, O loving Father, for ever and ever. Amen. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Every time we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, grant us peace. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who will call to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word and I shall be healed. As we receive communion, we do so on behalf of all of you. We do so in the expectation of the day coming soon when we can receive communion together. And as we do so, I invite you to receive a spiritual communion now with Jesus our Lord. The body of Christ. Amen. The blood of Christ. Amen. The body of Christ. Amen. The blood of Christ. Amen. I am the vine, you are the branches, says the Lord. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit. We bow our heads for a final prayer of blessing. Jesus said, my Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples. Let us go out into the world to bear fruit and glorify God. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Our final hymn this morning is Love Divine or Love's Excelling.